or first however minutes, no longer than 10, are devoted to public comment. Why don't we take public comment?
I'd like to thank you for those public forums, and I hope you got the message from the public. Contrary to what you may have heard, I did not get out the public. I didn't know any of those people. I just informed them that you existed and that...
Take credit for it.
I don't want to take credit for it. You take credit for it. You're doing the job. All right, and looking at your agenda here, I see there's more considerations this way, that way, and everywhere. And as a casual observer here, I'd like to say, I think you've reached the point that in education we used to call decision paralysis. You've got a real complex decision to make, and nobody really wants to make it at this point. And I don't know when you're going to have enough information or when you're going to have enough complications to go ahead and actually make the decision. And I think your decisions right now are two. You have two decisions, or a decision between two choices. You're either going to close the drop-off centers, Locust Street, and go to curbside pickup. So you've got to say, if we're going to close Locust Street, let's say we're going to close Locust Street and concentrate all your efforts on how to make the other system work. And if you're going to keep Locust Street open, then forget about all the other rubbish and just worry about how we're going to go ahead and decrease the amount of trash this Northampton produces. You know, you keep adding more and more options, which makes the decision even more and more difficult. And the differences between 2, 3, and 4 aren't really significant. All right, you've got two decisions. Keep Locust Street open, close Locust Street. And the sooner you get to that point, the sooner you're going to have something to recommend to somebody. But until then, you're just going around in a circle. Been there, done that many, many, many times. Got to sit down and say, do it. And the straw vote would probably be your first way to do that. And I told Wendy before, when you do a straw vote, it ought to be in secret. Only voting members should be at the table when it's done. And then you got to see, you know, if there's eight people for one method and one person against it, then why keep going a certain direction? There's nobody there to support it. Don't mean to tell you how to do your job, but since I've been that way a few times, I hate to see you going around and around. Enough for tonight.
Any other comments from the public? Any other comments?
Is that? I'm trying the camera. Okay.
Camera shy? Or?
No, I think there's a hair cut.
Hearing no other comments from the public at this time, we can turn to the minutes. Any comments, changes, minutes of March 7th? Mark has something, anybody else?
I think I seconded the minutes.
Can anyone remember who seconded the minutes?
I could be wrong. It's not a big deal. It's just
a complicated. It would be the tape on my phone.
Yeah.
It wasn't posted when I went back to check it.
Yeah. Why don't we, unless there's anything else, review the tape and just accept these minutes pending the confirmation of who seconded the minutes of the 28th, February 28th. Okay, is that agreeable? Okay, and I just want to say something before I pass the non-gavel to you.
Sorry, I'm late.
One thing is that I expect that as we move forward and get closer to honing in on a decision, that we will move more towards a Robert's Rules of Voting as opposed to consensus. I mean, it'd be nice if we can reach consensus, but I think it'll be probably more effective and more to take votes. So I'm expecting that that's what we'll be doing, but see what happens.
We have been voting on minutes.
Right, but I mean on other matters.
And we haven't done that.
Okay, so we have already on the minutes. Is there a motion on the minutes?
I move we accept the minutes of March 7th.
Is there a clear second, Mary Ann?
I guess I wasn't sure. She said, did you say the minutes of the 28th or 7th?
It was the minutes of the 20th are the ones we're referring to. Lack of clarity on the second. The seventh?
No, the
28th. The 7th is tonight. The 28th are the ones that were, Mark is questioning, we're the second, and we're going to look at the tape to see who actually seconded it. Okay? Does that make sense?
It does.
Okay. All right. Everybody, all in favor?
Aye. Okay. Wendy asked me to chair the meeting, take the chair, let them know.
I did, and I told them I was tired.
Good. I'm happy to do that. So the next agenda item is, and I apologize for being late. Next agenda item, discuss the public forum. I know Karen talked about putting together the comments and ideas and suggestions.
Technical difficulties, so it would be
Hopefully, people who weren't at the forum last Friday had a chance to review the tape. It was on NCTV, northamptontv.org, the NCTV website. I hope that happened. And we had about, just to recap that, we had about 70 people in my rough count at the Friday's community forum.
And 92 on Monday.
And 92 on Monday?
Some repeat customers.
And some repeat. Ideas, questions, ideas were generated, questions were generated, comments were made, feedback was given. What do people think? Anybody want to say more about Friday? Who was there? Who want to fill in those who weren't? Anybody who was there on Friday who want to say something about Friday's forum and work for those who weren't there?
I'll just say that I think it went very well. It went very nicely the way the first one did. I continue to hear from people who had a good time at the hearing. I think everyone who wanted to be heard was heard. And we continue, I'm sure we all are getting the various email inputs from. I wanted to ask, because we did chart some questions at both forums, and I understand you've got those. And I'm just wondering if it makes sense to look at those tonight, since we charted some questions and didn't respond to people. That's all. I'm bringing it up. I don't know. I want to look at them first.
What do you think about Fridays, Mark?
I have to say both the Monday and the Friday. I think the process was handled very, very well. And I feel that the process of having open public hearings is very valuable to hear what the taxpayers want in the city, how they want to dispose of their trash. And I think their voices, and like I said, I felt was very critical for me also to make a decision on which way that I feel I would want to go. I think the committee handled it very, very well. And it was amazing because we did have a different form of diversity at this meeting on Friday. So I really enjoyed that.
I'd like to say that some of the stuff I found very valuable at both forums, because I watch it online, is some of the ideas that people have. So we haven't even talked about. And I guess my thoughts were, I think it might have been valuable to have a public forum before we really got into the meat and potatoes of this whole thing, because it's like some people really brought up some really interesting ideas and thoughts that I hadn't considered. You know, especially I think it was Deb Jacobs who said she lives down a very narrow street that the post office doesn't even want to deliver on. And, you know, that was something that I hadn't even imagined that there'd be a street that perhaps a hauler wouldn't be able to go down, or how would you address that? And, it kind of made me think, and I thought there were some great suggestions. Some people said, you know, why not have like a dedicated dumpster in different wards or something. You know, these are things that weren't options that we didn't discuss, and I think that sometimes it's interesting to get people's ideas prior to them saying, we've all discussed it, you know, is it now too late to think of an idea like that? I guess I would suggest to the people who serve in the community who do these things more often than I do, that the idea of having a public forum prior to the meetings all being held is a useful tool.
Terry, you want to get your...
Well, I just, only in response to that meeting, there was a lot of discussion about the inconvenience of the trucks, but I think we've already agreed that there are trucks servicing almost 4,000 households. The trucks are already going down all of these streets. And the other thing about the dumpsters is an interesting one. It's all across Europe. That's the way they do it. And I've often thought about it. It's hard to imagine. You can see people sneaking out in the middle of the night, pushing the dumpster down in front of their neighbor's house, and the next day go back to the first house. It's just hard to imagine. But I keep thinking, like...
Well, even if it was just for recycling. I mean, yeah. I've had people say, like, if down in certain southern states, they, like at the Walmart parking lot, they have a place that takes all the recycling. So people don't have to go, they don't have to buy a permit because they can just dump their recycling.
Yeah, like the little round things for the cans and flat things for the paper.
Yeah.
One of the things that I am aware of is whatever recommendations come out of this task force certainly won't be the last incarnation of how the city manages its solid waste and recyclables. Hopefully. It's an ever-evolving beast, animal. And new technologies are coming up all the time, or current technologies are getting more and more feasible with the costs coming down and as the science improves. So certainly I think that it should always be looked at. I also thought there were some great ideas generated. The idea of a chipper shredder going around to different neighborhoods on a regular basis makes a lot of sense. And some other specific ideas generated, I believe that this will be constantly evolving, and hopefully constantly evolving as our awareness level increases about the impact that we have on the environment with our consumerism and therefore our waste, and how to minimize that impact. And as our awareness grows, so should our ways of dealing with it evolve. And I have a sense that it will.
I think another issue that I thought was interesting was just trying to set some, you know, set some actual good timetable goals, you know, because we don't know how it's all going to evolve. What would be the better objective? Currently, the city owns a landfill, and the city basically makes money on trash going in, you know, to the landfill. So we're in the trash business. And it's not always an incentive to push recycling because they get paid by the tonnage to put money in for the stuff going into the landfill. So I think that kind of changing how we think about the trash and, you know, making a move to being recycled is important.
Don't we also make money on recycling? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the more recyclable,
Okay. I just wanted to comment on what you said, and then I heard a disparaging audience reaction to what you said. I happen to live in the condo complex, which I've said, which does have trash, which has garbage trucks coming through. Very narrow area, they do it. It works. It happens. And they've been doing it for 20 some odd years. I don't know how many, but and the dead ends everywhere. So they manage to pick up at our driveways. We don't have dumpsters. There's no room for dumpsters. So it does work. It can work. And I just want to say that it can. See them tomorrow morning. In fact,
part of the givens when we started the whole process.
And I did want to read the questions, but there are some questions I think we can answer.
Just one thing I want to say for a moment. It's true we get money for recycling, but not sufficient money to pay for the process of collecting it and disposing of it. So actually recycling is an expense. It's just not as large an expense as handling trash.
And I also wanted to respond to, maybe I misunderstood what you said, but the gatekeepers are very good about removing recycling and with the new ordinance. I don't believe there's recycling going into the landfill.
Well, if they can see it. I mean, people bring in a big black bag of something. You can't really see it. I've been there, I've seen people. Yeah. There was something I wanted to say too about it, before we do the questions, Wendy, is I was speaking to a gentleman who works for waste management last week, and he told me that one of the issues that happens, especially with the snow that we had, which was extremely big this year, was that, you know, the narrow streets get even narrower because of the snowbanks building up, and that they actually had streets they couldn't get to. And so on their route, they wouldn't get there, and the garbage was piling up, and the people were complaining because of the garbage piling up. So I think that, you know, obviously it's not going to always happen. There's not going to always be these bad winters. But there are issues, I think, that with narrow streets that can create more of a hazard. And the thing with curbside pickup or anything, if, you know, if you're used to it coming and then it doesn't come for a while, you know, it's, again, it's not the same as being able to say, oh, I can just drive it down to the, having that other out. The other thing he told me is he lives in Northampton, and he said that, you know, the people put the trash out the night before, and the next day they were buried under the snow from the snowplow trucks going by. So there was all the garbage underneath the snow. So I just think that, you know, that's just something that, in passing, a gentleman who's in the business of curbside pickup, you know, did share with me that information, which I thought was, you know, very interesting. It certainly wasn't selling his business to us.
Would you like me to read the questions? There aren't that many. Well, there was one question asked. I don't know if we're ready to this. And we don't, that was asked of both, and that was, where is our trash going? And that came up a number of times, people at both hearings talking about being responsible for our own trash. And that now we are not going to be, because we don't have an option for keeping it in the city and dealing with it in the city. And that was a commentary at both meetings. So that was a question, and we don't have the answer. We have some options.
It'll be market driven.
There's a universe of options that's small but indefinable. If you would like to know what those are, then.
I think you've said earlier in meetings, but if you would repeat simply because that was a question and people asked that, what they are.
Well, the local landfills include Granby, Chicopee, South Hadley. That's it. Granby, Chicopee, South Hadley. That's it. There's only three landfills that I can think of in the area. And they're all slated to close in the near future, but just for information. There is a waste energy facility in Springfield and in Pittsfield. There is a large transfer station in just over the New York border at B3, we call it B3, run by Covanta, where sort of people bring trash. There are, well, BFI manages a rail line in Indian Orchard in Springfield, where they send their trash either to South Carolina or Ohio. And there is a landfill that some communities in Western Mass use in New York State, Seneca Falls, which is beyond, it's almost a Syracuse area.
Finger Lakes. It's beyond Syracuse.
Right.
Finger Lakes.
And that's it. Oh, well, I guess you could go to the Worcester Way, and there's a waste energy facility in Worcester, a little over here.
So all of the burning plants, when it says waste to energy, what do you mean? What does the energy part mean?
Well, it means that the trash is burned at a high temperature, steam is produced, and that's sold to electric facilities, to grid facilities to make energy. In Springfield, it's sold to Wamico, and they put it onto the grid. In Pittsfield, it's sold to Crane Paper, and it's used for the production of money paper. I don't know what wheel breaker does, but yeah, it's used to make energy. The material that goes into a waste energy facility is reduced by something like 80%, and so there's like 20% or less residual that then has to be landfill. And currently, the Covanta material, I believe, goes to Bondi's Island in Springfield.
What is the 20% that has to be landfill? What's that generally made up of?
Ash.
Yeah, but what's in the ash, I think, is where the question is. It's not used, it's not clean enough to be used as a cover, so it's landfill. It's not good enough to be used as fertilizer, that kind of ash, where they used to talk about that.
So they burn everything? Disposable diapers?
Oh, definitely.
Cat litter?
They burn everything.
Everything.
Yeah, at very high temperatures. You know, I don't want to get into debate about the technology, but you know, according to them, they're regulated, they feel more than a landfill is. So they feel their technology is cleaner than a landfill, and I'm going to get into debate about that. But that's
Do they screen the trash that comes to them at all?
Regarding?
Do they screen it? Or does it just come, the waste to energy facility?
It goes on a floor, and they're looking at it. Mm-hmm. They do screen it for radioactive waste, because I know sometimes that cats are being treated for leukemia with medicines that are radioactive. They pick that up before it goes in. Mm-hmm. I know they take out metal at the back end, but it goes in the furnace, and then they have a gigantic magnet that takes out the metal at the back end, and they sell the metal. But
and is there a higher cost for compared to other land? Compared to landfills for processing?
No.
So the cost, again, that's market rate.
Absolutely market rate.
Okay. And vary.
Yes.
Varying on an annual basis or?
Well, I think it varies if you're a contract community or a spot market community. And I think you'll find that as you look for a place. I can tell you, as being a 20-year contract community with the Covanta facility, the spot market pays less than we do, and I cannot tell you how irritating that is to me personally. But that's, and I think in Northampton, you price the bigger volume people pay less than the smaller volume people. So it's a business, the way they run a business. You might understand that better than most of us who ran a business for a long time.
Going back to the question, one of the comments I heard on last Monday night that I really thought was a great idea related to this question is maybe to have a billboard up showing where our trash is going. Somebody suggested that, putting a billboard up. If the transfer stations stay open, that's a great place to do it, right there where people are throwing the trash. If another option is chosen, perhaps a central location, or just making it known for whoever, if one of the other options of curbside is chosen, to make it be known where that hauler is taking the trash at all times, to let it be known.
If it's a private hauler, like a pallet waste or one of the Russo or one of those, mm-hmm. they may take it to point A, point B, or point C, or point D.
It's completely market driven.
Yeah.
Even if we did it, it would be market driven. We got a better deal, they'd make a decision. So
we have a blurb in the Gazette this week, the trash is taken to the...
Yeah, I don't know where the value is. I don't want to say that, I just don't know if there's a necessary value in that. What I think would be...
Make a decision.
Yeah.
Right, and what I think would be more valuable question. Would be that we do everything in our capacity to reduce, reuse, and recycle, so that whatever we are exporting is as much as possible.
And I also heard very clearly from someone on Friday that we, to the greatest extent that we can, make sure that if it's going to a landfill, that this landfill is environmentally sound and
as much as landfills can be. I mean, that's an oxymoron, right? But that the landfill meets and exceeds codes and practices, and that's a great idea.
You mean more so than the one that's located in the landfill section?
Right.
I think what I heard is that they wanted to be disposed in an environmentally just way, and the fact that it's either a landfill or it's a burn facility creates an environmental justice neighborhood, so it's catch-22. I'm not sure if that's the correct use of the term catch-22, but by and large, unless it's in an open massed area, if there's people anywhere near it, it's, and which is all of our facilities in Massachusetts, I believe.
Right.
It's not going to meet those. It's not going to meet that standard.
Well, I think that I just going to this question of where is the trash going to. One of the speakers on Friday said that we look at landfills that are not over aquifers, not within 500 feet of homes. And I think those are the two main points that she was expressing, and I thought that had a lot of value. As much as we can, as much as possible, but you know, keep just thinking about that.
I think in terms of putting together an actual RFP, that would be a very difficult thing to write into it. Mm-hmm. I think that we're looking at private business, running a business, and the things that you can put into an RFP are, we could certainly encourage someone to look at non-motorized transportation. You can look at responsible other things that you can put in there, but I think requiring them to use specific landfills or trash disposal, I would question how you'd be able to put that into it.
We would require in the RFP that they provide proof that the disposal facility or facilities that are going to be used are permitted with the appropriate agencies, and that, you know, in the state or federal government, they have all their permits and they're certified that they have those permits. One follow-up on what Elaine was saying with the disposal facilities. There's, if you have a contract with a big company like Waste Management, they own waste energy facilities, they own landfills. Solid waste generation across the country is down, these companies will prioritize disposal at waste energy facilities because those waste energy facilities generate power, they generate revenue. If an electron that's not generated today cannot be generated tomorrow, that's one of the reasons why the spot tip fee that Arlene was talking about is lower, because these companies will divert waste to these waste energy facilities. So in times like these, when these facilities aren't operating at capacity, the waste is going to get diverted to a waste energy facility rather than to a landfill. So if the city was to have a contract with someone like Waste Management, on any given week, disposal will go to one of their disposal facilities, but you don't know which one, and they may not be able to tell you which one until it actually goes there. So there are some factors there being impacted.
So you could write that into an RFP, you couldn't put it, but I was thinking that you couldn't put in there, we don't use on a barge sailing between New York and wherever, or that it wasn't going to be transported to Wisconsin, kind of. You can just say it goes to a...
Well, I mean, the baseline is it has to go to a facility that's permitted and licensed. Mm-hmm. And then if you want to take it from there, you know, then, okay. You know, then this, you limit your options. I mean, the city could say, if everybody here loves waste energy, thinks it's a great thing, you could say this disposal facility has to be a waste energy facility. Or you eat those, if you want to go to the landfill. You could say, well, we want to go to the landfill.
We could say it has to stay in Massachusetts.
Whatever decision you make will limit potential market and what the price would be. It's all, it's fine if you want to do it, but there are implications.
Well, in the end, our charge is pretty specific about collection. And not so much about where it goes, but I do think that we have an opportunity to make some broad recommendations if we choose to do so, helping the BPW and DPW by making those recommendations. In the interest of time, we're now at half an hour point, 5 minutes over time. Do we want to continue, dedicate a few more, five more minutes on discussing the
forum?
I would like to just, from a process point of view, we got these questions.
Okay.
We said, I think we can answer them pretty quickly. How are dumpsters that the city currently provides for volunteer community cleanup projects be paid for once the landfill closes? Is that an issue?
Could you repeat that? How would dumpsters?
Dumpsters that are provided for volunteer community cleanups be paid for once the landfill closes, is that?
We have a solid waste enterprise fund, which is churning with the money from the landfill at the moment. Clearly, the amount of money going through that is going to get much smaller, depending what we do in the future. There is no other money. If the amount of money going through the landfill, or through the enterprise fund, isn't sufficient to generate a small amount of profit, there will be no, or surplus, there will be no money for any other project. It'll come down to really stark choices. Lay a teacher off, or do composting. You know, I mean, that's a dramatic way to say it, but it's either got to come out of the general fund, or it won't happen. If our enterprise fund gets so tiny that there's no chance of generating a surplus of any significance.
So
paying for that dumpster presumes that whatever is left of the enterprise fund is healthy enough to write a check.
But then, at the same side, we haven't even begun to scratch the surface of solar power like our many fellow communities are, and if anything were to go, which it should, on top of landfill, then that's solid waste enterprise, that's solid waste enterprise fund money only.
Right.
Because it's designated that land, so it could potentially be very flush with cash, and we could be doing all sorts of amazing things. You know, we're waiting on Smith College to come up with something. So, you know, I hate to see us missing the boat, because there's all these great grants coming down the pike right now, and we're kind of waiting. So I just, again, there's definitely the potential. Everybody else is doing it.
Since this keeps coming up, could you address the reality of the timetable of that kind of a project, given the landfill's still open, given it has to be flattened out?
All I was going to say is you don't really know the answer to that question until you reach that point in time. So you know what your revenues are, carry the same, maybe revenue streams that we don't even know about right now. We may be, there were comments about the city shouldn't have employees at haul recyclables. Well, if we have employees in a truck and the ability to haul materials, if basically it wants to have a special plastics collection day, then we have, you know, do we have enough money in the budget for someone to work half a day of overtime to take that box that the city would own and then haul it to some particular place, and maybe we'll have money to do a special collection of it. That seems like it wouldn't be a lot of money, but until you reach that point in time, you know, what we have for staff, what we have for equipment, what we have for revenue, what the special collection is, I think we don't know the answer to any of those questions.
I want to recognize the mayor.
Thank you. I know in my notes, that's really wonderful. Option one is huge. Where people had spoken in favor of option one. I think also on Friday, we heard about dogs in general and the wards getting together and having a cleanup day and apparently using some form of a barrel where we'd be able to go ahead and if there's any kind of waste from the animals on the dogs, that would go there.
Disposal was on the list. Can I just
finish
this? Why can't the remaining capacity of the landfill be restricted to Northampton residents only?
The problem with the landfill is it's regulated by state and federal regulations, and the process of opening the gates, fulfilling all of the regulatory requirements, and planning for future closure gives us a fairly fixed amount of overhead. So there's an actual break-even point for the landfill, which is in excess of 40,000 tons per year. So if we slowed, we're permitted for up to 50,000 tons per year. So let's say we slow it down to 25 and stretch it out for an extra year or two, we're also running at a loss. And again, it'd be a mystery as to where that extra money would come from.
You mean the overhead? This is a question that I've had for a couple of years, and I've actually gone before the Board of Public Works, I don't know if you remember, asking this very question. Because it just made sense, if we kept it to Northampton only, we'd be able to extend the life of the landfill. And maybe then by the technology would catch up and be cost feasible of some of these technologies. It costs, what you're saying is it costs X number of dollars per month, per week, to keep the landfill open, and we have to spend that money to meet regulations.
And the our payroll obligations.
Payroll obligations, but I mean, I would assume that if there would be some layoffs, unfortunate layoffs, if we were to restrict it to Northampton only, and, but, so keeping the personnel costs down, there are fixed costs that are beyond our control due to state regulations of running a landfill that we have to pay for, that need the money, the revenue from the other towns in order to meet.
40,000 tons.
We need the revenue coming from the tipping fees from other towns in order
right.
to meet that fixed cost.
If I could use an example, let's say a fictitious realtor who has an office in Florence. There's an office, there's heat, there's lights, there's doors, there's advertising. Imagine a business, you know, by the time they open the door the first day, they've obligated themselves to pay a certain amount of money before they've gone out and listed a house. And the landfill that we have has a certain amount of built-in overhead. And we started from scratch to do a landfill half that size, what we've been told over the years is that you couldn't even do it. We already operate like a little hobby landfill. From the industry standpoint, they don't come any smaller than ours. And we're bumping into the smallest possible sized landfill that can actually run in the black. But I think Jim has some thoughts on that, if I may.
I think you described that pretty well.
I just had one thing to add, is that if we serviced only the residents of Northampton, then the cost would really be very, very high because we're doing this boutique landfill.
Cost to who?
The cost to the Northampton residents.
Residents?
Yes. So what we're trying now is to sort of phase in so that we are doing this in a thoughtful manner so we won't have like a huge amount. But let's say right now each resident, I won't try to put dollars on it, but you have to raise the cost so much in order to keep going just for the residents. And it may not even be feasible to do that.
I just want to say something. One is, I think that part of it is that we also are considered a regional landfill. That was part of our designation. So we get money from the state to host 44 that other communities or whatever it is. It's called the host fee. It's about 300.
That's not that from the state.
No. Where does the host fee come from?
That's it's a little bit of a made up name, but that's what we call the payment that the landfill makes to the city. Basically, we move the surplus every year over to the city. And as in a sense, it's compensation for hosting the landfill. The money that regional designation goes back to some grants I think we got back in the 90s. There was some money available for building out some of the infrastructure that was available to regionalized facilities. So that regional aspect qualified us for that grant money.
Does a private group run your landfill?
Yes.
I think what happens there, help me if I'm wrong here, but in South Hadley, a private company runs the landfill. They get paid X amount to run it. They sort of set the tip fee based on their costs. Mm-hmm. And but part of that's not the case. You set the fee. Okay, you don't run like that. Okay. Because the host fee there is every time it comes in. So part of that money comes to the town of South Hadley.
that's what they call a poster. Maybe it's different.
It's a little bit different.
Okay.
I think the way they're describing it's like, you know, revenue from our cooperation.
Dick, do you understand the cost of revenue?
I'm going to want to move things along here and just to try to
understand.
Did you want to continue?
I just, recyclables make money for the city. Now that changes all the time.
But they haven't changed the contract.
So in difficult economic times, we get a base fee of $15.67, and then there's
from
the Springfield MRF, and then there's
per ton
of paper or bottles and cans. And in better times, we get a revenue share. Right now we're at, 34?
Total is 44. So that's the 15.67 plus the revenue share.
But as Terry said, the cost of collection and transportation doesn't actually make us money overall. It's still a cost.
Big question, why can't the Locust Street transfer station be the one to remain open for options 3 or 4? As opposed to, we've been around on this a little bit, but someone would like to highlight the pros and cons of the stay away from that one.
Well, I don't have a lot to say about it. This task force can consider that. Locust Street has limitations that Glendale doesn't in terms of space, the ability to collect certain materials. It's such a good locator, which a lot of people raised. And I think before the forums, I had indicated, you know, that you could look at Locust Street. You could discuss it originally. Part of the matrix thing that I had talked about involved having a discussion about each transfer station, open, closed, what materials, yes, no, whatever. So, there are pros and cons, but.
The mayor specifically asked us to look at construction and demolition, hazardous and electronic waste and bulky item and metal management, and that just is not feasible.
Not feasible?
Yes.
Because of the size?
And not enough room, not enough space.
Room.
There's a lot of things going on at Locust Street besides just it being
right.
A transfer station.
The barn.
In terms of, well, roads, sewer,
right.
Street,
roads. Civil operations.
Yeah.
In what way is a city curbside collection a pay-as-you-throw system?
The current one?
No, a curbside.
If you get option 2, 3, or 4.
In what
no,
way?
No, I'm reading it the way it is.
Yes.
Yeah.
In what way does
so,
a city market
how could
curbside
a curbside program be changed?
How would it operate?
Well, for example, those... three different sized totes that we saw in here, they would be different prices. Communities have different ways of handling, these are hypothetical
right.
ways you could solve that. Communities sell bags for the overflow, so you could have three yellow bags next to the tote that you usually use. So maybe Thanksgiving you have a couple of bags next to your tote.
Or all bags in any barrel.
Yeah.
Why is there not an option 5 that closes both transfer stations and lets residents rely on the Valley Recycling Facility?
Well, I don't think I can answer that.
Did Buddy Dusong ask that?
I was going to say, would you like to answer that question?
Well, wasn't that something we handled in the beginning? We said that we felt the city had a role in, that would be the washed hands approach, correct?
Yeah.
We shut everything down and just said, okay, you can go to a private, that's the washed hands, and we
did
not do that.
Yeah, that's an evolving situation.
Yeah, I think that that in fact is going to Valley Recycling is an option for everybody, regardless of what option the DPW goes with. That's as long as they're in business, as long as they're competitive, as long as people want to go, that will be an option for everybody, and that was stated pretty clear. I don't know if we didn't state clear enough. We obviously didn't state it clear enough.
That's the end of the questions.
One of the things that we had talked about was that we would look at multiple ways of collecting community input. And one of the things that Wendy had asked last time is if I could do just a brief summary of what's come in from emails. And so I tried to summarize that as best I could. It was, I think the summary of it was basically We had 9 different emails, all that were supporting pedal people. There was a lot of support for them. We had 2 people who wanted to maximize reduction and increase recycling and diversion of waste. There were 3 that were in support of pay-as-you-throw, 1 in support of purchasing bags at local stores. There was 1 that was multiple local recycling centers. There was a question in one of the letters about increasing that we would look at not only residences between 1 and 4 families, but also additional. One person felt that any municipal plan should include organics collection. There were 2 people who referred to diverting reusable and salvageable items. One person was commenting on need-based discounts. There were 2 people supporting citywide composting. 2 people with concerns about bears and other animals with a curbside pickup. 1 letter that was discussion of disposal of pet waste. It was a very different kind of response than we did at the public forums. There were no letters that were specifically in support of option 1. 2 that were supporting option 2, 1 in support of option 1. And I think none for option 1, 2 for option 2, 1 for option 3.
Yeah.
Yeah. Option 3. And I think that one of the questions I have is when we have 50% of the people who are using curbside pickup from private contractors, where their voice was and why they weren't represented at the public forums. Because obviously there are folks who are not now using the transfer station. So I would question if we're getting the word out to people or why those people are not coming to us and giving us their opinions. So I think that it was great that we had 160 people out and strongly in support of the transfer stations, but they're also the folks who use the transfer station.
And I'm glad you read those off, but I'm also listening on those 2 forms, which is much different than what you have with emails, of agreeing on option 1.
Okay. It's just saying multiple ways of collecting the information.
As far as the people who have curbside pickup, the fact that thousands of people are spending approximately $400 a year is, I think, that's a vote of a type. Thousands and thousands of people.
This is a very difficult thing to do, but thank you for doing it. But I do see if things are not mutually exclusive, that if someone expressed interest wanting generally waste reduction and somebody else said specifically pay-as-you-throw, that certainly goes towards waste reduction. They're not mutually exclusive. It's hard to be supporting organics because that actually does reduce waste. So it's hard to categorize it like that, but I really appreciate doing that. Yeah?
This came from a conversation with Arlene before the meeting started. I thought it was a good question to ask. What additional information do we need? Maybe do a go around to make decisions. Just throw that out there.
Does anybody need additional information? Anybody looking for additional information before we do a vote on our top option?
I guess what I'm not saying we're about to vote on anything. I'm saying we have additional questions that we know stand in the way between our individual perspectives. Because I haven't gotten clarity by any means. I wouldn't say by any means. A little clearer. But I'm still sorting out what it is I need to know to help me move towards a decision. So that was really, I think that was what you meant, and that's what the question is.
I don't know that it's right there in the agenda for here.
I'm just throwing it out.
Maybe it's more for later on in the meeting. But I think before you can, I think my thought was, you obviously need to make a decision in the next three meetings, and
what is it that's, what more information do each of you need in order to make that decision?
One of the, this is generated by a responder, and I thought it was really good, and I don't know if we can get this information, but it was the air quality information that might, that due to per trip load of all the different people picking up trash. So in other words, is there a way to compare curbside pickup by one hauler, thank you, versus using six haulers in our city, and what the impact is on air quality? And I thought that was a really good question. I don't know if it's possible to get that information, but I would like to see that as a way to talk about that repetitive, as a way to quantify, not everything can be quantified, to quantify that repeated trip. What somebody from Fort Hill Terrace said, we have four haulers that come down our street plus the pedal people. And so there's the intangible cost to roads that we can't really measure, but maybe we can measure air quality effect from repetitious quality trips. So.
Relative to the Arlene's question, I wonder if that would be under item six.
Future dynamic planning can put these steps. That's a good point. So,
well, she did ask.
Yeah. So is there a way to quantify?
Oh, sorry.
You're just totally kidding me out.
No. Yeah, man. Oh, yes.
Well, I mean, there's a way to calculate just about anything, right? I think the difficulty is picking that accurate number. It would be certainly a theoretical exercise because we don't know which private haulers fit on the streets. So we definitely have to get an accurate. We need to make a list of assumptions and then calculate emissions based on your assumptions on what the vehicles are, number of stops, and that sort of thing. But it could be done. The question is, how accurate is it? Does it reflect reality?
Is it feasible to get, I don't think that the private haulers are wanting to, I mean, they could give us the number of residences they serve, and I think they have given us the number of households they serve in the city, but not who, therefore we couldn't do a big map and calculate the mileage driven each week for each hauler, because I don't, you know, that's the private information that they would.
Can we just assume that multiple haulers will emit more emissions than one truck going up the street, picking up all the trash and leaving it?
Generally speaking.
Can I just also say, can we also just say that even if we do, if we were to opt for curbside, that there can still be the same amount of private haulers floating through the city? I mean, it doesn't mean that all of a sudden you're going to see all of those trucks go away. What you mean is that you'll have our private hauler on top of whoever else might be there. So. It doesn't, one does not automatically lead to the other. You know, there's businesses who are in contracts with the haulers that they can't get out of. There's all sorts of things, so, you know.
Yes. This is really going back to two things that jumped out at me from the forums that are complementary. I know one of them was that the issue of that, I know this to be true wherever I go, as long as I've lived in New England. People don't like change. And we talked about that early in our meetings, and that came through to me from the hearings in terms of people who do things a certain way and want to continue to do them that way. What, to me, I found complementary to that were a few comments about phasing in or having an implementation plan for whatever we do. Maybe not right off the bat, let's choose this option to do this. But can we look at this and maybe, you know, can we phase in some kind of plan over time? Is that a possibility? And that's kind of what arose for me as issues and complementation.
Okay, in the interest of keeping the meeting moving along, we're now probably 25 minutes behind schedule, and we have a very big top agenda item here, in number five. Agenda item number four reviewing changes to table one. Do we have copies of the new revised table one to hand out?
I don't know what they're referring to. Was it just the senior citizen household?
That's what I understand the change was.
That's all there was.
That where it says where we went back and forth
Actually, there was a couple of changes.
Senior citizen household to single person household.
The
question is, where is it now? Senior citizen or single?
That assumption of trash generated both in the table one and in the PowerPoint presentation was based on section 5.1 of Stantec, which was referring to senior citizen households. And so table one, first column, should be titled senior citizen household, not one person household. It was amended, from what I understand, because we started talking about removing a discount for the cost from strictly senior citizen based, strictly age-based, to perhaps need-based, and that decision hadn't been made yet, and so the discount criteria under that column was taken out until that decision was made, and therefore, from what I understand, the title of that column was changed, and senior citizen was dropped from that column, but the problem with dropping the senior citizen from that column was that the amount of trash generated per month was based on a senior citizen household according to Stantec 5.1, which is what's cited at the very bottom of that table. And I don't have my latest table in front of me.
I mean, I'm just trying to understand.
Yeah.
Since our time is valuable and money is short, I'm just wondering, are we nitpicking about a senior citizen household and a single person household? I mean, are we talking about it being 5 extra gallons a month or 5 less? I thought the issue that came up with this table was the fact that a one-person household was 40 gallons, and if I am one person and I move in with another person, how do we all of a sudden jump to 140 gallons rather than 80 gallons? That really the issue was making the table linear, so that if we're just going to say that a one person makes 40, a two-family would make 80, and a family of four would make 160, if I'm doing my math right sometime. But I think that was the issue, more so than trying to...
Early on, it was explained that the senior citizen number was less than the per person trash number that the DEP uses, that Stantec used in section 5.1, because it's widely regarded and believed that seniors generate less trash, consume less, purchase less. Therefore, less trash, and conversely, the household of four typically involves kids, and kids generate more trash, and so the linear relationship isn't there. It's not four adults living together. It's more of
I don't take that to exception. You keep saying those, making those statements, and it's really not.
I'm just saying what was explained to us about the assumptions of trash. Something the amount of trash.
But the fact that the whole thing you're saying, kids generate one. None of this is, all of this is individual.
Yeah.
And I was walking my dog the other day, and I have a family of five, three kids, two adults, one barrel, and a bunch of recycling. And I went and said, there you are. You know, you one barrel, and it was a week kind of thing. All these things are just complete generalities. The DEP number is not a Northampton number. It's a state number.
Right.
DEP has a bunch of numbers. So when you're pulling the DEP number, I go, well, which one are you using? Because, you know, we say 4 pounds a day, we say 2.9 pounds a day, we do an EPA number. We have 1.5 bags a week per household. We have numbers coming out of the gazoobies, and every number is based on what the town reports to us.
Right.
They're just not scientific.
Right.
The best standard to use is what do you generate in order to go through this chart. And it's not, all this stuff, I would burn it. I would just say, what do you generate going through this chart?
And I also think that we're getting so bogged down in trying to determine cost. And, you know, we spent so much time back and forth with cost that when I went to go write my PowerPoint and write my article, I was obsessed with cost because that's all we've been talking about for weeks and weeks. And I would rather spend some time tonight while I'm still slightly awake on reduction ideas and thoughts on that, because I don't know how much more we can.
Yeah, it was a change that was made from the forums. In the forums, table one's handed out with that one-person household on heading column one, and it should have been senior citizen household. That's what the StanTech report says, and that's on the note number two, at the bottom of the table one, says that it came from, and so therefore, table one is evolved yet again.
Super. I'm
going to
move on.
I agree. So, next agenda item is to talk about discussion topics: waste reduction, reuse center, discounts, difficult to manage waste, population served. We've allotted 45 minutes for this discussion. It would put us to 8:15, and we would be then 15 minutes over our timeline. Do we want to still say 45 minutes, or do we want to say 30 minutes? Keep it to 30 minutes.
Let's do our best to keep it to 30 minutes.
Okay. In which case, then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 topics, 6 minutes each.
Well, it's not going to take 6 minutes. So just keep it.
Okay, let's go. Waste reduction.
Who doesn't like waste reduction?
I have a question. The Mass Highway site, I know there's issues about whether or not we have the money to do it and all that other fun stuff. I'm not asking for an absolute answer right now. But when I see in the newspaper that the city's considering spending like $100,000 or more than $100,000 of the CPA money on building a park, I have to wonder, is CPA money something that can be used to help construct the Mass Highway site? I just think it would be a better use to benefit everyone in the community.
It's not historic, it's not recreation, and it's not housing.
Okay. All right, well, that answers my question, because
there's four uses for it. What's the other one?
Open space. Recreation, portable housing, and historic.
Right.
Sorry. Well, I thought you were going to ask about a timeline or ask about, you know, the potential reality of real, you know.
Well, they keep talking about that there isn't a reality, so I don't know if they would like to comment on it, but.
My understanding is even if they were to resolve all of the outstanding issues and hand over the deed tomorrow, there's a substantial amount of money that would be required that we would need to invest before we could do anything. The building is a teardown. We would have to really build a fairly substantial amount of pavement there, come up with engineering studies, figure out a traffic pattern, put in the type of pavement that would be appropriate for heavy trucks to be coming and going. The state is retaining the ability to use a salt shed there. So I see we could burn through $500,000, $1 million, I think, really easily before we could take the first bag of trash. Long term, I think it's important that the city buys that. It's a fabulous piece of land, centrally located next to our DPW facility. But it's not at all clear we could easily make use of it in the near future.
Carrie, would you say that it is a time, we don't have the information in terms of time, we don't have the information in terms of money to have it be a relevant option for this?
I know 4 years ago there was a study, a committee put together that looked at and decided that site would be the ideal spot for a reuse center. I know I'm jumping ahead to reuse, but it seems to me like that work has been done and that site was identified as the ideal spot for reuse. The reuse committee in 2004, referring to it as the V-Bay Center, identified that location to be their number one location for such a thing. And so the pursuit of that space continues, the pursuit of that estate is, from what I understand, I was on the Senior Center site committee trying to find a site to locate the Senior Center, and finally we found Conn Street, or we decided to be the Conn Street. Mary Ann's on that with me, Councilman Large. We also looked at DOT site as that was our number one.
My number one was right on Conn Street.
Oh, really?
So in any case, for a long time now, that site's been looked at, but push me, pull me, it's been happening. The state says, take it, but clean up the brown fields. And the city's saying, we don't want it, you clean up the brown fields. And so we're kind
of
like
that's been resolved.
A lot of that's been resolved.
And in fact, the way we, my understanding is the way we will eventually get it will come with fewer restrictions. In exchange for us maybe taking a little more responsibility to use on study. But I think we're fairly comfortable with what they're asking of us.
Well, I think the biggest issue with Jane Ontario is the fact that it's going to take hundreds of thousands of dollars just to acquire the site that the city doesn't have.
Well,
that's pretty much where it's at.
You mean buying it from the state? I can't imagine.
He just described all those things, the engineering and studies, the traffic.
It's not acquiring it. It's getting it up and ready.
Yeah.
To do something.
Yeah.
Okay. It's money that's necessary to acquire it. And that involves things like Mass Highways requiring that the city build on salt sheds, build on a new access road off of Locust Street. We need to take down the building. There's an old landfill on the site that needs to be capped. There's discussion about that. All these things cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. And trying to work through those issues in terms of what the city's going to pay, what Mass Highways are going to pay, and what the liability in the future is going to be in regard to the site only to be worked out. But the bottom line is that there's hundreds of thousands of dollars that would be necessary to acquire the site that the city doesn't have. I believe there's an item on capital improvements committee that would address some of the costs associated with site acquisition.
Well, with that being said, the idea of a resource recovery park seems to be something that the majority of people support. Is there something that the city, or is there, you know, there are some other ideas that were thrown out, you know, have have some of the schools sponsor something, you know, where people could bring it in, there would be a day doing that. I think someone suggested having, you know, there's free cycle that people have to sign up for, but having a citywide free cycle, like through Northampton.gov, that people can put stuff on that they have. These are things that I think, any step in this way is the right direction, just trying to get that going.
So that's something that we as a committee can, yeah.
I'm not clear, and this is just a general question for the committee. Can the committee propose that, for instance, that we do want to have waste reduction, and we do want to have a reuse center, and we do want to make sure that we increase the amount of organics. Can the committee make that recommendation without getting into specifics in terms of implementation?
I think we have, I don't think we have the expertise.
Right, so I guess what I'm saying is maybe we should be talking about the specifics that the committee wants to recommend these specific things, then we strongly recommend them, but it doesn't mean that in fact we have to come up with the plan to implement them.
Well, I think we should absolutely define though what we want to see, because just by saying we'd like to, we recommend there should be waste reduction in the city. Well, that's a lovely statement, but it really doesn't mean much of anything. So I think we should try and say waste reduction by these means. You know, we maybe don't have to go into specifics how we implement it, but
or where.
Right, but I think that's a good point. What I'm saying. We're gonna have to cut it off at some point, but making the consensus or the agreement of the committee on specific areas.
I was going to say, I think that those are very strong messages that we've gotten over the past several months, is that whatever we do, we want to be sure that the amount of waste that the city produces is reduced. We want to increase recycling. And what we want to look at and what we want to make a statement about is what is the best way to do that and what's the most effective way to reduce the amount of waste we're producing. So we want to absolutely increase the amount of recycling that's done. And how do we make that easy and simple? And how do we encourage the most people to recycle the most that they possibly can? And that's how, when we're making our recommendations, we want to look at what's feasible and what's the most cost-effective way of doing that. And I think that one of the things that we've been hearing is that I think we've all been in support of the pay-as-you-throw that people should be responsible for the amount of waste that they produce, how, whatever we decide. That people who produce a lot of waste should be paying more. Those who are very recycling-minded and very responsible should have some benefit financially for doing that. So as we're making decisions about what we decide to do, I think those are kind of universal themes that we've come up with. So we want to encourage recycling. We want to have some sort of pay-as-you-throw. Am I not speaking for all?
No.
Okay. So whether we do stickers or we do buy your bags or whatever we do, whether we do curbside pickup, we have to look at what's the best way for us to make it feasible so we can encourage the most people to do what is the most responsible. And I still, one of the things that I go back to is that it's great to have an education program, but we still have to make this financially something that makes sense for people.
Well, I think we should also look into
Sorry,
I was just going to ask people whether you read what David sent, David Starr, who's not here tonight, and whether he gets more specific, but on the same general themes. And it seems to me we've got some stuff to look at that we can point to and embrace or not. And also Karen's, which was a whole way of looking at things, but I think had some really wonderful, exciting ideas. And I just think we could take a look at these documents that we have to as discussion points.
I didn't get Davis.
Were you not able to?
I just wasn't able to get that, so I don't have his. I was at work on it, so.
Just
a
way of background.
Here's a copy of it. I still have it on my computer.
Just by way of background, I thought maybe Roland and Karen could describe a little bit to the committee. The Board of Public Works has a solid waste education action committee that's involved in waste reduction efforts and coming up with different ways to reduce the waste stream and diversion efforts and that sort of thing. And they've had some success over the last few months, and the board has a charge there to look at a number of things that that the task force is also interested in looking at. So I don't know if you want to describe a little bit what's happening in the committee or how there is a little bit of there's an ongoing effort that exists. So
for about a year and a half, a subcommittee of the Board of Public Works has been trying to figure out how best to educate the public, because there is this ongoing issue with the facts keep changing, and we keep trying to figure out how best to do it. We work with gatekeepers at the Locust Street transfer station. I don't know if we also work with Wendell Road transfer station. And working really hard to get a website up so that people can go to the website and say, this plastic and this clamshell, is it recyclable or not, before I put it, so I know what part of my trash to put it in. But it is a very hard thing. But the Board of Public Works has been working very hard on this for a while. It's just, like everything else, takes a lot of time.
So I'm assuming this input, all these comments that we've gotten are going in those ears of yours.
Oh, well, David Starr serves in the committee as well.
Yes.
That's right.
Okay, Marianne.
I've just gotten to see David Starr's also, and I have to agree with what he's saying about public education.
Well, I would just like to say that in looking at Karen's, and I see that she would like to see a organic collection, I guess, organic composting at the Glendale Road site, which I'm sure would not be welcomed by the community there, who's had to put up with that for some time. Well, what I would like to know is, you had a grant some years ago, I think, to do something, and what would happen with that, and why was that turned back?
Deferred to Jim.
The grant program, the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission has a grant to look at organics management across the basically the 9 Mile Corridor. They completed a study at the end of the year. that drew some conclusions and indicated the need for additional work in terms of enlarging the potential area where the organics could be collected to make the financing work a little bit better. They received an additional grant from DEP that would allow them to extend that study, and my understanding is that study is ongoing right now. So they were looking at the waste shed for food waste collection, and how much material would be collected, and where and how it would be managed.
But is this the current one, or is this the one that happened years ago?
This is current. It was a study that was done, that they completed in December, just this past December.
Right. I'm talking about, my understanding is it was a few years ago, there was a grant that was given, and then the city returned the grant to the state. This was right around the time where the expansion was heating up. So I'm just curious if you can tell me why that grant was actually turned back to the state.
He actually never accepted the grant. Mm-hmm. And it was at the, it was after the site assignment, but actually the plan was to go from conventional composting, Windrow composting, to another technology. But there was a very small window between, you know, because it was going to be using the same area where the landfill expansion would go. So my view is that, you know, we had a short window of opportunity at closed.
And in talking to, again, the gentleman from Waste Management that I happened to come in contact with this week, he told me that the biggest problem with doing organics, you know, of doing food waste, is that the weight of it, that it's extraordinarily heavy because of your, it's not just doing the trash, you're dumping all the food, and it's extraordinarily heavy to transfer. And he said that the problem with that is getting it to, you know, hauling it to a place or anything else like that. So really, to have smaller areas that would actually do it rather than having one site where it's being hauled to. So again, going back to that idea, it would seem to me that if we were going to do something like that in the community, I'm just putting this out there, that it should be in a more centralized location where more people have access to it rather than, again, on the outskirts of town. But that's just my concern.
Okay. Moving along on the agenda, to cover everything, it's crazy that I had the sense we're going to be talking about waste reduction in everything that we do. As Donna said, I think that is an underlying theme that we may well have consensus on in the reuse center as well, as part of waste reduction and alternative recycling. So let's talk for a bit about discounts. This was on the agenda. People want to talk about discounts.
Is this just an issue of whether or not we recommend that there should be some form of discount, and then it would be up to the Board of Public Works / City Council some capacity to determine how that would play, I imagine?
It should be.
Okay, and so we're in agreement that some kind of discount program should be in place, whether it be age-based or needs-based.
I'd like to say that it is
needs-based. You'd like to have it be needs-based, not strictly age-based. And so I think we have another consensus recommendation.
I think you already did that much.
Well,
that's okay. It's a move.
Certainly, I want to again express what the mayor left a message. When I asked, I left a message for her asking, you know, is there something now that the city does that we could use and not reinvent the wheel and have it be the same criteria that in her message back, plain phone tag, said there wasn't anything in particular. There may be some things in the schools or the rec department, but she wasn't aware of any specific program that's in place now that has a needs-based
we're going to let the DPW decide. Figure
right.
That one out.
Right. And her concern on her message, just to express what she said on her message back to me, was that she wants to minimize the administrative burden of doing something. She's concerned about the administrative burden. But again, I think the details of that can or cannot be worked out, not by this task force, but by the people who do it full time. More than full time. So there we are. Difficult to manage wastes. So a topic that we have punted from agenda to agenda to agenda to agenda. This is,
Karen's idea.
I think what I'm understanding that this is an all-encompassing phrase to include bulky wastes, such as mattresses, tires, appliances, furniture, white goods, as well as hazardous wastes and e-wastes. Is this true? Is that difficult to manage? That's the umbrella term for these specific categories of bulky and hazardous.
What can't or shouldn't go in the trash?
What can't or shouldn't? Can't fit in the trash
bag. Regulate it out.
Can't fit in the trash bag or the trash barrel. Can't put a love seat in a 40-gallon trash bag. Or can't go in the
waistbands. Yeah. Prohibit.
And so we, and that is in fact in our charge to consider household hazardous and electronic waste, construction and demolition, and bulky items and metal management. I think that it becomes self-evident that it depends on what option is recommended, the curbside or current system with transfer stations. This is going to be, this is going to change. Of course, under option 3 and 4, this allows for,
yes.
Right, with every option that's available, but yeah, the specifics of it. Options 1, 3, and 4 call for a combination of transfer stations. In option 1, there's some things that are collected at Locust Street and currently, and some things are collected at Glendale Road. Under option 3, there'll be some things collected by the contractor, the contracted hauler, and some things that will be collected at Glendale Road in option 4. Same thing, actually, as option 3.
I have a question. I happen to actually go to the landfill this weekend. I don't get to go as often anymore. But I went and I was dropping off some old computers, which I think were like $5 each for the locker, which I thought was extraordinarily low. It seemed to me that it would have to cost more for the, I don't even know what happens to the locker. You know, of course, you get horror stories of where they go. But I guess I'm curious about, when we talk about the city handling these hard to manage waste, what do you, like, who comes and hauls them, or do we take them somewhere? Like, what is happening with them? Did you already do that?
I've done some research into it,
yeah.
And I asked specifically about electronic waste, which is something that I've been concerned about for a while.
Right.
I think your question is a little broader, but I was more specific about electronic waste. And
mattress. I mean, like I said, I thought the cost was, I was expecting to pay like $15 or $20 for a monitor. I not to keep going back to my friend in the waste management, but he told me that to get like a truck to come out to our business to haul it, it would be $75 just to have the truck, you know, and then they would charge us per whatever we put into the truck. So,
For me, the thinking about this, if I could just speak, is a point of diminishing return, where you want to make it, you want to cover costs, so you have it be what it costs. But if you have it too high, in order to, I don't know what, encourage people to keep the monitor another couple of years, then you run the risk of illegal dumping.
Right.
And so there's that, just like the bag, the sticker fee. For the bags, you make it too high to encourage recycling, mm-hmm. you run the risk of people start doing illegal dumping, not only in the meadows or the woods or whatnot, but also downtown trash barrels or conveniently located dumpsters.
Right.
That's not authorized that you use.
So, I mean, in your suggestions, you're saying let the city get out of that hard to manage waste. That was your, as a citizen, private citizen suggestion.
Yes.
And I guess I'm asking if we were to get out. Because I'm trying to see what the benefit obviously is to try and prevent illegal dumping of the mattresses and meadows, even though it still occurs to this day and all the other things that happen out there. But I'm just trying to understand that. It's hard to manage. I mean, I can understand medical waste, but I'm kind of thrown by it.
Well, valid recycling isn't really the only option. There are many services that will come to your house and pick up stuff. Mm-hmm. Or if you contract with a waste hauler, that, you know, you make an appointment and they come pick it up. Mm-hmm. And there's, you know, all kinds of businesses that specialize in that kind of thing.
Right.
And many things, you know, you can bring to Salvation Army. There's other ways to, you know, you don't necessarily have to bring it to a disposal facility.
Right.
If it has useful life.
And is the, I mean, I would imagine like a washer or dryer, that's a metal recycling that, so that would just be taken to where?
Metal recycling.
Right, but like a mattress, I mean, I know there's facilities that actually, I know they're hard to recycle mattresses, but they do because of the different sizes, that's my understanding.
Do you have a contract with the guy in Greenfield?
No, our mattresses go to Millbury.
Do you go out to bid on all of these things every year? Or how do you know, how do you determine who is going to take?
Some are on state contract. State provides,
right.
You know, massive.
But your choice contracts,
even all choice state contracts. Like the Horizon Bulk, CRTs.
Right.
A lot of that is on state contract. The metal recyclers abound in Springfield area.
Yeah, but how did you decide Millbury as opposed to WTU or wherever else you could bring
it? It fits in the incinerator and probably, and it's a
effect. But you went out to bid for mattresses, or you went out for all your bulky waste, or whatever.
That's part of the landfill obligations code.
Okay, so it's
the material.
It's up to the operator to.
Well, it does depend on the material you're talking about.
But it seems to me, Mr. Chairman, that every option, as you said in your opening comments of this discussion, addresses hard to manage waste. The city's not going to abandon. This committee
right.
has made a commitment, and I think DPW's commitment, to not abandon the management of these wastes, either through providing lists of where people can get rid of them, or services
right.
within the city.
It was
beyond micromanaging that concept. I think you've already acknowledged that every option.
In every option, there's provision for dealing with hard to manage waste, difficult to manage waste, and in general terms, I think you know every option has that covered. I'm just going to hand this out because we need you to open the door first. this is an article that goes towards electronic waste, written by NPR. National Public Radio did an interview with the executive director of Basal Action Network, Jim Puckett, last December, which was a real eye-opener for me, and it kind of spoke to something I've been thinking about for a long time. As our society moves to be more and more e-aware and e-consumering, what is happening to all of our e-waste? And I've been more and more concerned about this, especially after hearing this interview on NPR. And so I hand this out just for informational purposes, and I don't know quite what to do with it other than I've done some research on how Northampton handles its e-waste, and I expect in next week or week after that I may be looking to make a recommendation, broad recommendation about that, because the Basal Action Network does some really great follow-up, not just what the problem is, but then how to address the problem for organizations, businesses, and cities, municipalities.
So.
Okay, no, the last item here, I'm sorry, we're going to be a little bit over here. Population served. We had restricted our options to 1 to 4 family households. I'm sorry, 1 to 4 family unit dwellings. One single family homes, duplexes, triplexes, and 4 family homes. This was on the agenda to look at this.
And so I guess I'm going to put it out there to why is it that we are looking at just 1 to 4 family homes? I don't know the answer. It came up once or twice during the community forums. And so maybe there's somebody who might us.
Well, the task force is welcome to discuss that and change that. It wasn't a recommendation. It was a decision that we had made when we put together the cost tables. We needed to estimate a certain number of households. So we went to 1 to 4. We took that number and used it as the basis for all the calculations that we did. The 1 to 4 number of units is a number that's commonly used by communities. I think Arlene would be able to speak to this a little bit. And I think it's a decision that every community wrestles with. You know, what are the limits of the service that our community is going to provide? So that was I don't think it makes a lot of difference in terms of the cost, but we need to make a decision when we put the numbers together so that we get the number of households, and that was where we were. I've got some demographic data here. I don't know if you're interested. I've got 1 through 5 units, 1 through 3, 1 through 2, so that I can hand that out if you're curious to see.
Is that 2000 census?
Yeah, the 2000 census.
2010 census is information not available, right?
Well, buildings don't change.
I think historically, the numbers went.
Yeah, but it's units. It's not people in the house. It's number of units in the building.
I think if you look back 20, 30 years in the Commonwealth, when many communities, more communities were picking up the full cost of solid waste management in the tax base, and they made a decision as to what was a business and what was a residential unit, the configuration of the 1 through 4 was more carried forward. As communities segue to more fee for services and get away from the tax base, which is really the trend, is moving toward more fees and less everything in the tax base, it doesn't impact as much if it was 5, 6, or 7 or whatever, because people would be assumedly paying a fair share. So it doesn't matter so much if it's broad in the cities. But Pittsfield, for instance, they just went from, I believe, 6 down to 4 because it's city-based, it's tax-based collection, and they found that the larger units were less responsible. They have unlimited trash, were less responsible in terms of the amount of trash they were generating. So they reduced it to try to save money on the tax base. So I think that's sort of what it is. I don't think it's a one-size-fits-all. Again, it's a financial issue by and large. For communities, and in the case where if it was a single hauler contract and everybody was paying their fair share, it would be a political decision.
Well, one thing that I know as a realtor, condominiums contract with their own trash hauler, and there are 2-unit condexes out there. There are triplexes, there are 4-unit associations. And then certainly 5-unit and 6-unit, and then 100 units at Laurel Park, and I think 100 units at 90-something at Fairway Village. And so condominium associations contract with their own haulers to do, based on, I'm sure, the cost and perhaps other criteria too. And so that's always been a kind of question for me in studying this, is what do we do? I mean, there's no way the Board of Public Works could make a decision about collecting trash and recycling that would mandate that the condo associations take part.
They're private businesses.
So it's considered a business. Condo associations are considered business. So condos certainly are numbered. I mean, there are condos in this city that make up part of the 11,000 households.
I'm sorry, but is the question about whether or not we are going to offer it for 1 to 4, or whether or not we offer it to everyone and may not put a restriction on it,
or something in between?
Yes,
and then looking at the demographics. What the impact is.
So we can't, we have no impact on condo associations.
What do you mean?
Well, whatever recommendation is made, if it's, if the board decides, if the recommendation is for options 2, 3, or 4, curbside pickup, excluded from that obviously are businesses. And so the condo associations are considered.
But why are they obviously excluded?
Because the associations contract with their own haulers to do their trash.
But could they end their contract with their hauler and contract with the city? I mean, yep. They might be able to. They may not be able to sign up right away. They might have to,
right.
You know, if you miss your date. I've just learned all this stuff. But so if they get to the point where they can sign up, maybe it won't be this year. Maybe it would be, you know, it'd be
right.
The following year.
Yep.
But if you could offer the condo association a better rate.
Right, and that's
right. What and I think I mentioned that I asked Hampshire Property Management what the actual cost is per unit, and it was astronomically lower than anything else I've heard. So we're not like, you know, unless it's inaccurate, it's only $135 a unit.
Per year.
Out of our condo fee goes toward weekly, separate, you know, we put the bin of recycling and we have the trash.
That's where.
And that's what I was told.
And that's not unlike my town. If I took the contract, question disposal contract provided by the number house, that's about what we can do. So that's because it's a big contract.
But it's the economy of scale.
Exactly.
Right. And that's where we're going there.
Consistent.
The more diversity in properties that you consider managing, the more difficult it is to characterize what the collection is. Mm-hmm. If you've got 8 units, they need a roll-off box. If they have totes, they need twice a week. You know, so you can go through every property. So if you look at sort of a blanket 1 to 4, you can sort of envision that almost like a one-size-fits-all collection type of strategy might work that vast majority of sizes. And you start getting a little bit bigger than that, then everything, you know, it sort of one size may not fit all. And then you may have to go to every single property that you're thinking about servicing and then finding out, well, are they room for totes? It's a condo. Do they need they need a roll-off box? How much waste are they generating? How many times a week do you need to go through? How do you end up charging if someone needs a box? How often, you know, how are you going to charge them a fee for that versus someone who's going to use a tote or a bag? Or if you're going to pay as you throw, how does that impact, you know, these complexes with more units?
Let's say we went out for curbside bid, among 4 units. And we got 60% or 55%. Would it be possible? Would that beg the question, should we open that up more to get more participation, or am I not thinking straight on this one? Keeping it 1 to 4, going out on a 1 to 4 bid, and then would it be likely we'd increase participation? I'm thinking back about phasing and implementation, which I said earlier. Trying out, it's making recommendations, but allowing for plan A and plan B, whatever.
Yeah, because I was thinking the same with you, is like sort of like you'd start with 1 to 4, but you know, if you had to, you know,
that's the kind of question you talked about, would you be in the process of doing that, and you can see if they can advise you the cost effectiveness of that. And the other Jim's point are excellent in terms of the more complicated,
yeah.
The more difficult, the more configurations that the hauler has to do, and it may not benefit. The contract.
And I think the assumption is that the haulers are already competing for the business of those multiple units. So if in fact a hauler had a contract that was citywide for curbside pickup, it seems that they'd probably be a very competitive bidder also, competitively with other bidders for those multiple units. So that just makes sense.
I just had a quick point from the audience who does commercial stuff. You're often talking about completely different trucks, completely different collection containers. So I would not assume that.
Okay.
Right, because they're not universal containers.
Right, I mean, you're often talking about, you know, the stab and grab front load dumpsters on a commercial account.
which is a completely different truck, a completely different route. You don't get that economy of scale by doing something that you're picking bags off a curb.
Do we know how many different haulers are using toters?
Somehow the city has to accommodate the municipal buildings and schools, and those things require the kind of the dumpster pickup capacity, the toter pickup capacity. So if you do go for a single hauler, you're going to have to, I would assume, address those kinds of facilities, and so any hauler is going to have to be able to do both the curbside thing and the commercial thing. So that's going to be.
So if we look at these numbers, if the total number of housing units is approximately 12,500, and we're taking 3,000 off for those that are 5 to 20 or more units, we're talking about 9,000 units that we're making a recommendation about. That's 75% or so of folks totally. That seems like that would be a reasonable thing for us to make a recommendation on. That's a determination.
Well, again, that's assuming options 2, 3, or 4.
Or option 1, which is
option 1,
which is just as it stands now.
Right. Which is all households.
Right.
But we'll have to consider.
Well, it's not all households now because those households have private homes. You're right.
All right.
So
I'm happy to stick with 1, 2, 3, this one.
But maybe considering going to that.
I think it's in the spirit of phase in as much as we can. I mean, there's no way to phase in curbside pickup. You either go for it or you don't. But we don't have to go for the whole enchilada. Mm-hmm. If it's a rousing success in years to come, the 5 and up units may want to come in, and we certainly can address that as we come to it.
Okay, we have gone over our time. So item number 6, future agenda items, planning concluding steps. I'd like if you would read the question.
Okay, the question is, what additional information do we need to make a decision? I think we as individuals, in order to reach a committee.
Is there anybody who needs more information? Bo, you mentioned you'd like information about
air quality.
Yeah, but we all backed off from that and said that we just assumed that a multi-hauler system affects air quality more negatively than, that's a stronger statement.
Any other information needed for people to help them come up with their... Okay, for process, I just want to reread that we're charged with making recommendations, plural. And along with that, will be clearly laid out alternatives with their associated costs. And I'm going to assume that that has to be an estimated cost. We don't know what the associated costs would be. We won't know for many of these options. We won't know what they are until we have a good estimate of what they would be. But we won't know what they are until an RFP goes out and it's responded to. If curbside collection is the top recommendation. With the option 1 and keeping the current system in place and keeping the transfer stations open, we have the estimated costs based on overhead and hauling, overhead covered by the permit fee, allowing the truck to go through the gate of the transfer station is going to cost this amount of money to cover the overhead. And the cost per bag will cover the hauling. Do I have that right? Yeah,
Mimi. Well, I was just wondering if we could possibly take maybe one of the members of our audience's suggestions. Since we don't have as many people here today, I don't know if we're going to have a fuller group the next week, is to do a silent straw vote and see where we're leaning and go from there, because it just seems like we need to formalize where we are with the position. And if it has to be silent, or I mean, I don't care if it's public or not, but I just think that we should have it, see where we're leaning as a group, and because we have 2 weeks, we've got to put together a report in 2 weeks, we've got to make it organized, and I don't think we have to go back and redefine all the options again, because I think we're all pretty familiar with them and their associated costs and what those associated costs are based on. So I would like to say that for our next agenda, that we do a straw vote.
Well, can I suggest that when you say straw vote, to me that means, I mean, that sounds like it's just a preliminary vote, it's not actually what our vote is.
That's right, that's all.
And so I think that so much of our ancillary recommendations, if you will, our primary recommendation is going to be collection, how we recommend the trash is collected. Our secondary recommendations be how we can reduce waste. And perhaps manage hazardous waste, or perhaps bulky waste. But our primary recommendation is going to be how waste is collected. It goes to what Donna was saying earlier. We have some underlying agreements on reducing waste, using pay-as-you-throw, establishing a reuse center. Those underlying agreements that we've already come to. So I would actually, just to feed the bill on that, to say, well, we come next week prepared to list our top option, our number 1, 2, 3, or 4. And we will then know what our options are. And we also know the estimated costs that go with them, so we fulfill that part of our charge. It'll be a majority rule decision. I'm sure we're not going to have consensus, and that's okay.
That's fine, but again, I don't know if it's necessary to have to come in here and say, well, I'm putting them in this order. Mm-hmm. I think we all probably have a number one, and obviously I think that, I guess I'm trying to,
yeah.
We would have that number one, and then we would be able to have a discussion from that.
Yeah.
So, to me, it seems like, I'm not trying to cut through things, it's just that I'm trying to make these things be efficient. We've got 2 weeks left, and I think that what's going to end up happening, my other recommendation, is there's going to be, as you say, some dissension somewhere. So there will be a majority, I think the charter committee's done this already, there's a majority report and there's a minority report. And so whichever would be representative of the side that comes in second or that's not as recommended by the group would be able to write
the
feelings behind that. So I think that I just think that we need to, we got 2 weeks. And it takes a while to write stuff, it takes a while to get it all formulated, and I just kind of want to, and we've talked this thing to death on, like, with all the options, so.
Yeah. Are people,
Well, I just want to be real clear about costs are not just necessarily monetary costs. So for instance, if you, Marianne had mentioned that a lot of people from the forum a week ago were very supportive of the locust, of maintaining and keeping the locust street transfer station. However, many of those same people said that they're very concerned about environmental issues. Well, those are diametrically opposed, because if you assume that trucks going around the city are going to have more of a negative impact than having the transfer station open. I mean, the cost might be cheaper for some people to have Locust Street open, but the environmental costs are greater. So there's a lot of different, just to say option one, option two, option three, and option four is muddying the waters of what the public gave us in terms of their feedback. And I'm just pointing that out, that it's not all just about dollar costs.
But that's something that we all, in our understanding of this issue and following through and hearing those things, we set out that one of our parameters to determine this were the non-monetary costs. So I think that when we come back here next week and we say, I vote for option this, or I feel this is the best option right now for the direction of the city, one would hope that it's taking into account
more than just one factor that's taking into account all the weighted factors we've been discussing. An effort that would then lead to discussion as to why that's the choice that you made, ultimately, is what I'm thinking.
I may have been so wrapped up in making sure everyone had a chance to speak that I missed this discussion, but I feel like we really haven't talked about curbside and in any in-depth way, in the sense of the environmental impact and its comparison to multiple holders or individuals driving their cars to Glendale and Locust and all of that. Just we haven't really talked about it. I think we've been afraid to talk about it. Maybe I'm wrong. I feel like it's been out there. I was upset because the paper said that's what we're focusing on when I never said that, and I didn't feel that way, and I certainly haven't made up my mind, actually. But I feel like since that time, we haven't really talked about what it means, all the implications of doing curbside. Am I wrong? Was I not here?
What you're saying is you would like to, and that's fine.
Well,
I could be on a Jedi.
Well, we did talk about the non-monetary costs.
On
the table too, like a bulk. And a big piece of that was the environmental benefits, and that's why options 2 and 3 at the time, we had 3 options. Options 2 and 3 ranked so high was the environmental benefit of curbside pickup, and that was a big discussion that we had.
I guess we've just had it piece by piece, and we haven't had it all in one place to talk about potential costs.
Put on the agenda.
That's true. We're setting up next week's
agenda.
Of course, you could come in next week and you could have a majority of people say they're in favor of some form of curbside, and then it would be a discussion as to why. You know, I mean, I guess.
And the details.
Yeah, I mean.
That,
or the implications of that decision.
Exactly.
Right. I'm not clear yet, and I think it's because I don't feel like we've discussed it fully.
It would take 10 minutes. Discuss it. Put it on your agenda.
Yeah.
You're going to spend more time deciding if you're going to discuss it.
We can put that on the agenda.
Okay. You know, again, that's going to be 10 minutes of something fresh in your mind. I guess I'm, you know, I'm not trying to not. It's just that we have 2 weeks.
Yeah.
We've been discussing this ad nauseum for many, many weeks.
All right. So you're suggesting that when we vote, or
I would just think that we get to this point. I think that at this point, we should all have in our mind what these things are. I mean, I go home and I think about this stuff. I go home and I'm much more aware as I'm driving. I see the homes with the trash can. I see the different kinds of trash cans. So I'm trying to be aware, you know, in all the different areas of the city that I go to. So I'm looking at the curbside. I went to the landfill this weekend, and I was, you know, actually surprised at how nicely the Locust Street transfer station runs with cars moving in and out, and how poorly the landfill runs. I mean, there's no lines. It's like all of a sudden we were stuck and surrounded by all these cars, and we needed to move, and we couldn't do anything. Whereas Locust Street's much nicer. So I'm actually, you know, in the sense of like being aware. So I mean, I don't know how much more we can talk about curbside other than, you know, I think.
Well, if I can suggest to because I'm kind of task oriented now, because we have 2 more meetings, and I think that next meeting we need to make a decision on which of the 4 broad options we are going to recommend. And I think you're right, we don't need to rank all 4, just pick your top 1. Because we can present, well, we will present, I'm sure, we're going to present all 4 of these to the Board of Public Works with their estimated costs, as we're charged to do. And then there are ancillary decisions around organics, construction, hard to manage, and waste reduction, reuse center. And I think that while I don't think we'll have consensus on the option, the collection options that we use, I think we probably will. In fact, I think we already have had consensus on the ancillary recommendations. Regardless of which option is chosen, that it thinks to me that the reuse center is something that we're all going to be recommending. The commitment to waste reduction, but the specific recommendations of what that looks like, including the reuse center, we can make recommendations around and set the bar for the Board of Public Works to make their decisions on. So I propose that we put out as a committee,
as a task force, that all task force members come to next week's meeting prepared to...
I'm not sure I'm going to be able to come to next week's meeting.
But perhaps you could let it, you know, me, Courtney and I, or to all of us, yeah, actually all of us.
Well, before the meeting, I think it'd be better if it just went to maybe Karen. So we're all at one time.
Right.
Not put her...
That's better.
Okay, yeah. Okay. To have your, I envision this, that I'm going to have a list of recommendations of 4 or 5 recommendations. Number one is going to be which option or collection. And then options around organics and waste reduction. And some difficult to manage options. And then there may be more decisions that need to be made, more additional decisions that are made at our last meeting, and then we have a week to generate the report, and we can decide at that meeting how that's done, including, I like the idea of a minority report. That's like the meeting.
I know, but we're going to.
You don't.
It would be nice if we all agreed, that's all I'm saying.
Right.
Who's not going to be here?
I agree with you with that, and with me bringing up about the charter committee, we did have a citizen who came in later.
Right.
Okay. And he worked very hard, but it was not what we were charged to do. We spent from April right up until this month finishing.
And you had no staff support, which was the biggest advantage.
Okay, well, we can decide.
Who is not going to be here next week? Two of you will not.
I'm not sure if I will be here.
And I don't know that David, I think, will be. Both Davids, I think.
But can you get your list of recommendations to us?
I'm already making notes.
You're already doing it? Okay, so
I just want to say, it's not necessarily that we have to have minority report. You might have consensus. I just think it should be an option in case.
We can decide whether or not to have minority report next week, or even the week after that.
I think you can write up recommendations with there was concern about the following issues.
Exactly.
And right. I think it doesn't have to be a whole report.
Right.
I think that if people have concerns, I think that's certainly something we can go in. I just don't want to sabotage efforts before we can start.
Right.
Right.
No, I agree.
Right. I mean, we have a broad charge. We have an opportunity to really move the ball forward in how the city manages the solid waste in a way that increases recycling, reduce, and decreases solid waste wherever it may go. Any other agenda items for next week? I think we have a full agenda. I mean, that's certainly... Do we have other agenda items we need to cover? Okay, so with that, I move to adjourn the meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you.